Welcome, dear viewers, to CouchWarrior TV on YouTube. I am the CouchWarrior, and you are watching Arcanus Arcana, a Skyrim Let's Play. Well, welcome everybody to Chapter 4, Part 1. At the end of Chapter 3, Fleet finally became a full-on member of the Dark Brotherhood. We've been assigned 3 contracts, and we are going to fulfill those contracts. At this point, we're trying to prove our worth to the Brotherhood.
You're part of a family now, Hamshank. I trust you, you trust me. Got it.
At the same time, we are also going to prepare ourselves for the imminent arrival of the Night Mother, which we heard firsthand from Astrid. So on the agenda for this episode, we are going to craft ourselves some new garb. And the reason that we are doing this is because Fleet has learned some things about the Dark Brotherhood and consequently some things about himself through research. And he has come to the conclusion that the coming of the Night Mother and his arrival at the Dark Brotherhood shortly before her arrival is no coincidence. He believes that there is some kind of fate or some sort of divine providence that has drawn him to this point. He's becoming a more spiritual person. One of the things that he believes is essential is that he basically get his act together and present himself in more of a favorable way. So, In a somewhat ritualistic way, he is going to craft his own vision of what this stage in his career as an assassin should look like. And I think the act of crafting his own armor, his own equipment, is going to be important. It'll be almost as if what he is creating is something like religious raiment, right? That's not something that you just find lying in a ditch or pull off a dead body. That is something that you create and that you maintain and that you respect, and you create it in a certain way. So that's kind of his view right now of where he's at. He's interested in gaining the respect of his brethren and at the same time presenting himself in a way that sets him apart and is respectful and is befitting of his new role and his new life. So, we are going to do that. And in the interest of kind of fulfilling this idea of ritual, the armor that he's going to create is going to be unique. And it's something that he's going to have to spill blood to create, and something that he will need to create in complete privacy, almost as if it were a meditation. So what we are going to do is, the first part of our objective here is we are going to find a secluded place with all the facilities we need to build what it is that we need to build. And we're going to make sure that we have the materials that we need. I believe I have almost everything I need at this point, but you know, sometimes I don't know until I get to the blacksmithing area or get to an anvil. I realize, ah, shoot, I was missing something. So hopefully I've got everything I need. The idea is we're going to replace our main clothing set. The Dark Brotherhood armor that we were given, we will wear pieces of that, pieces that are important, but the rest will be unique to Fleet and reflect his style and his more contemplative approach to the Dark Brotherhood and its philosophy. So if you remember, in the last episode, we talked a little bit about Dark Brotherhood lore. One of the things that is apparent here in the Skyrim version of the Dark Brotherhood is that they appear to have fallen out of favor with their deity. For whatever reason, they speak only to the Night Mother right now, which, in my view, is, in Fleet's view, is more equivalent to a patron saint than it is a deity. Sithis is the deity in question, and they have been cut off from Sithis because they've gone so long without a listener. So Fleet views that as a weakness in the organization, and probably in more of a subconscious way, he's interested in doing anything he can to help restore the organization to its prominence and bring back that spiritual aspect of what used to be at the core of the Dark Brotherhood and what made them so powerful. So he is kind of taking on the role of not just an assassin, but almost a scholar. And one of the things that he's going to be doing is seeking out books that will teach him anything that might be valuable, might be of value to that mission. One of the things that's important to understand, and that would... Headshot. Okay. One of the things that is important to understand and probably impact Fleet quite a bit is his background as a man who comes from a wealthy family. He would have been exposed to religion, and more than likely the Cyrodiilic version of the creation myth. And that creation myth basically says that there are two original spirits at the beginning of creation, Anu and Padme, which are also known as the Et-Ada. And Anu represents what could be characterized as order and light, and could be represented by perfect stasis in a more metaphysical way, right? Where if everything is order, then everything is on a consistent trajectory. Nothing ever crosses, nothing ever changes. Whereas Padme represents chaos and darkness. And that might be represented by a bazillion particles all flying in separate directions and colliding with one another. So with that idea in mind, I'm going to make a bunch of leather here. I think I've got tons of pelts here. I've got everything that I need from pelts, so I'm going to convert all of this to leather before we get to our final destination. So with that idea in mind, the way that it works is that these two original spirits, one representing light and one representing dark, fight over the gray area. The gray area between them is represented as an entity called Nur, which is depicted as a female who is in love with Anu, and Padme, being jealous, fights with Anu for her affections, and then the blood that is spilled during that battle becomes the Aedra and the Daedra. The blood of Padme alone becomes the Daedra, and the blood of Padme and Anu mixed together becomes the Aedra. And essentially, what Padme is Sithis. So when you consider kind of the structure of the Dark Brotherhood, that really makes Sithis the ultimate power, because Sithis is one of the original spirits, or one of the Et-Ada, and it makes the Night Mother nothing more than a mouthpiece for him. So, well, look at that. It's like the Macy's Day Parade. Oh my god. I've seen glitches before, but where's he gonna land? Whoa, in a tree. Oh my gosh. That's just about the weirdest glitch I've seen in a long while. I haven't seen a glitch that bad for a long time now. we're just going to let that go. That's a bit creepy. I didn't even have anything to drink before putting Fleet to bed last night, so you can't blame it on booze. I can't see it from here anymore. Okay. Anyway, that idea of the creation myth is going to influence Fleet and really is what makes him believe that Sithis is the ultimate source of power. Sithis represents change and, in essence, creation, because nothing can be created in perfect stasis. Only in a state of chaos can things be really created. So, in his mind, that makes Sithis the more powerful and the more relevant of the two original spirits. So, his devotion to this idea of Sithis is going to be pretty strong. The Night Mother is someone that he would... I'm going to put an arrow down here. I know there's a guard down here. I'm going to try to draw him away so I can get a clean shot. I don't know. Maybe I'll put one in the carriage. Or the cart. Now that woke him up. Why is he running that way? I'll put another one in the cart. Come on back. Ah, he saw me. Okay, we will drop down onto this frame here. Ugh, I'm gonna slip down, I guess. Okay. There he is. He sees us now. Come on, buddy. Follow me down here to the road. Let's have at it. There we go. If you haven't guessed it already, Ambershade Mine is going to be the secret lair where I'm going to perform my little ritual around creating this gear. It's private. It's got just about everything I need, with I think the exception of a tanning rack. But I just used that tanning rack up in that bandit camp, so I should have the materials I need to at least make my gear. That's the important thing. The other thing that I'm going to need to do is I'm going to come up with some kind of alternative for carrying all my equipment. This backpack has been great. It's added about 50 points to my carry weight, which is pretty essential at this moment. I have ditched a lot of things, but I'm going to need to replace that. So I'll be making some kind of alternative to this backpack, which I don't think would look particularly good with the new gear that I plan to create. All right, so we're going to take these guys out. First, I'm pulling the torches. Pulling the torches as I go through. By doing this, I'm preserving some darkness, and I'm also making sure that I'm not backlit. I don't want to be silhouetted against the light when I attack them. So I always put out those torches. Ah, look at that. Look at that. Drives me bananas. Okay, we'll let them come. So we pull back into the darkness. Now, they can't see us at this point. They're following the sound. Done. All right. That's two. At this point, I'm not overly concerned with loot. I'll take the gold I find and anything that's obviously valuable, but I'm not going to search every square inch of this place. I'm mainly interested in their smithing tools. All right. So over here, I'm going to pull this torch, make this hallway nice and dark. This one I'm going to leave. And the reason I'm leaving it is because I'm not sure if I'll stay in this room or not, but if I do stay in this room and they decide to pursue me in here, they will be backlit when they come into that opening, and it'll be easy for me to hit them. So I'm going to drop this bridge, and we'll see what happens. Okay, I'm going to scoot straight across here. Okay, we're drawing him down that hall. See now he's silhouetted. easy to see. I can pick them out. Although I don't like the fact that I can't tell where the other guy is. We're going to give him some distance and then come up behind. All right, here we go. This one is a guy coming at me. Here he comes. Down. All right. Pretty clean so far. The other thing to remember when you're pulling these torches out, darkness does help with stealth. So putting out or extinguishing torches along the way is going to give you some benefit where stealth is concerned. But you also have to remember that you're not just putting the torch out. You're actually taking the torch. So you can become overburdened with torches in a real hurry. So every once in a while you want to go through the old inventory and dump off all the extra torches you're carrying. All right. I'm pretty confident I'm going to bring the bridges up. I don't want them to escape. I want everybody in here dead. So now I'm going to sneak through here and take this stuff. I think what I'm going to do is, instead of going down around the corner, I'm going to fire through this opening and draw him into the storage room, and we're going to eliminate him here. This has the added side effect of, you know, he opens the door. There's no lock we have to pick. I don't know if it's locked or not, but seems convenient. There he is. He's down. All right. Now we can kind of move around the outside here. I thank you all for watching. Obviously, I decided to transition us into a new chapter. It just seemed like his induction into the Dark Brotherhood was a great place to cut things off. And oh, man.
Listen, hear me and obey. A foul darkness has seeped into my temple. A darkness that you will destroy. Return my beacon to Mount Kilcreath, and I will make you the instrument of my cleansing light.
What she doesn't understand is that I hate being people's instrument, so to speak. So it'll be interesting to see how this plays out. For those of you who aren't aware, that was the Daedric Prince Meridia asking us to return her beloved beacon. All right, here's a guy. Nice long shot. Okay, that ought to attract a couple more. There's that silhouette we like. And that does it. I think we've cleared the place out. Now essentially we have a really nice kind of underground workshop available to us. Total privacy, where we can do our thing and we can kind of emerge with the new items that we need here. I believe I have enough material to create the apparel that I want. I don't believe that I have all the materials I need to create the added storage capacity. I think I'm short on leather for that, but we can get the basics built and then we can pick up the rest in Riverwood. All right. So, we need to get down to work. To start with, I'm going to take off the backpack, take off the hood. And we are going to use a couple mods here. We'll be working with a couple mods. This will be the first set of apparel that we will create using the Black Mage mod. We will also be using the Bandoliers mod to create our extra carry capacity. So to start with, let's go down and look at leather. I've already created enough leather to make these things. What I'm going to create, however, is only two items at this point. I'm going to create this Black Mage mask, and I'm going to create the robes. and we will see why here shortly. Okay, so I'm kind of conserving the leather that I'm using here, but my plan is to kind of combine the black mage pieces with the pieces from the shrouded armor that I like. So we'll be using the shrouded armor gloves, boots, and hood, and then the black mage robes and mask. Now down here under miscellaneous, I can create some buckles. These are buckles that I'm going to need when we create our bandoliers. Now I can take the leather that I've got left in my inventory and I can dye it black. To dye leather black is a requirement if you want to make a black leather bandolier set, and you dye leather black by combining at a blacksmith forge your leather with frostbite venom. So you have to accumulate quite a bit of frostbite venom, but it's one vial of frostbite venom per piece of leather, and then when you have enough black leather on hand, you can start crafting those items. Okay, we can see I'm over encumbered here already. I've added robes and mask and all that stuff and taken off my backpack. So I'm pretty sure I've done all I can here, because you actually craft the bandolier sets using a tanning rack, and there is no tanning rack down here. But this has allowed me to create my apparel. So I'm going to put the pack back on, and I'm putting the hood back on here. And now we're going to make our way to Riverwood. We are going to go ahead and craft our bandolier and pouch sets so that we can get that carry capacity up without having to use the backpack. And then that'll put me in also a good position to buy any additional materials I need going forward. So what you do is you create a bandolier, and then you can create separately a shoulder pad for the bandolier, which allows you to increase the carry capacity of the bandolier. And then once you've created the basic bandolier, you can start creating pouches that can be added to the front or the back. They can be large, they can be small. You can create different combinations of pouches and place them where you want on your body. And each pouch that you add adds anywhere from 25 to 50 additional points of carry capacity, depending on which one you craft. Nothing in there. No, we didn't check this body out yet. Now my intent is that for the moment, I'm going to focus on the Dark Brotherhood quest line. The Dark Brotherhood quest line is... currently, I've got 3 contracts to fulfill. One in Iverstad, one near Windhelm, and the last one in Dawnstar. So these contracts are going to take me to a couple places in Skyrim where I've never been before, where Fleet has never been before. So we will need to go to these places, carry out the contracts. So we're going to be doing quite a bit of overland travel, and we'll see what ensues. If something interesting comes up between here and where our targets are, then we'll pursue those things if they fit with our stated goals. All right, so now we're going to head down here to Riverwood, and we're going to craft our bandolier. I'm pretty sure we're going to be a little bit short on materials, so I'll probably have to buy some leather to finish it out, but we have already dyed everything in our inventory black, and we have the required buckles we need, I think, to make the basic bandolier set. So you go to the tanning rack, and then under the leather option, you'll start getting a whole pile of things. You start with this basic bandolier. Once you've created that, then you can create the shoulder pad, which increases the capacity of the bandolier, and then you can add pouches, back left, back right, front left, front right, and there are larger pouches and smaller pouches. So I am going to add, see these Dark Brotherhood ones, those were the ones we were talking about previously. where you can actually dye red. I'm not doing that. I'm just going straight black at this point. So we're going to add a large one in the back to increase our carry capacity there. They give us another 50 points. Okay. Now what I want to do is add a couple small pouches in the front. So I just need a couple more pieces of leather to do that.
Whatever you need. Looking to protect yourself or deal some damage?
I don't know exactly how many I need. So I think maybe a nice even 10. I'll take 10. Eventually I'll be able to use some of that to upgrade what I've got on, so. So I gotta take it to the blacksmith forge now, if you remember, and I gotta dye it black. We'll do that first. Okay. I only had 2 vials of the frostbite venom left, so we've got 2 pieces. I think that's probably going to be enough for us to make the 2 small pouches that I wanted. I hope so. No. Kind of thought that would be enough. Oh, I bet it's leather strips I need. I bet maybe I ran out of leather strips. That's probably it. I just went to check to see if I could make anything with the iron I have, and I couldn't make that either, so let's do some leather strips. All right. Now, that should be enough for me to use the iron I've got in my inventory to make a few daggers. A couple of those. And have plenty of strips left over for the bandolier. Let's check. There we go, that's what I want. Front left. So it was leather strips I was out of. I've got just enough leather to make one of these, so I'll just make one. That's another 25 points. So I believe the bandolier gave us 75, the addition of the shoulder pad gave us 100, the large pouch in the back gave us another 50, and then another 25 on that for the small pouches. We've just increased our carry capacity to by 175 points, which is quite a bit more than we had with the backpack even. So we're going to go here in the home of our good friend Findall, and we are going to change into our new gear here. So let's have a look. So there's the mask. The reason I like the mask is it can conceal your face, of course, but it can also be enchanted independently of the cowl. So eventually we can do that. Okay, so one of the things I'm planning to do here is I've been using these bracers. I've been using the bracers for enhancing my archery ability. What I really want to do is have the Dark Brotherhood gloves become part of my permanent rig. So if I have those in my loadout, I'm losing the bonuses on archery. My plan is to... That looks pretty good. My plan is to use the gloves on my hands for the backstab capability and then transfer my archery bonuses to the mask so I can make up for what I lose by shedding the bracers. The mask just looks cool, too. It looks kind of menacing. So we add our bandolier. Let's see how that looks. It looks pretty nice over those robes. Okay, that adds the two pouches in front there. Okay, and then we have the one large pouch in the back. And that's actually added as as kind of a satchel, so there's a shoulder strap. It's not attached to the belt, it's actually a satchel with a shoulder strap. Now the one thing I am losing, of course, here is these are robes. They're not armor. So I am sacrificing some protection for the sake of looking how I want to look. And my view is that if you're going to play an assassin, it's important to fit the role in whatever way you choose. And this is, to me, an assassin should be, especially a Dark Brotherhood assassin, should be menacing. And this is kind of our transformation from, you know, the mountain man / highwayman traveler to something official. And I think the apparel, given the objective here going forward, should also convey sort of, I don't know, kind of a theological type of, you know, or a religious type of look to it. So I'm pretty sure the guy said I look like crap. Yeah, look at that. Rock joint. I must have been sporting rock joint for a while now. I knew I do have one cure disease potion in here somewhere. I just got to find it. Well, viewers, I hope you are all well. I thank you very much for watching. I think that this is probably a good point at which to make a couple of quick announcements. The first one is, you may have noticed I have added an additional mod here that enhances how characters look with a bow and in stealth mode. So you can see Fleet's posture has changed a little bit when he's in stealth mode. And when he actually stops to fire his bow in stealth mode, he drops to one knee. You can see even now when he's standing motionless, his posture is a little bit different. His stance is a little bit different. Thank you, viewers, for suggesting all these great mods. I've gotten so many wonderful comments and lists. People are sending me lists of mods, and I haven't checked them all out yet. I've checked out a large number of them, however, and found some really wonderful gems. So you'll notice that. The other thing that I wanted to make you aware of is that I have been in negotiations recently with an organization called N4G TV, which is a network or news for gamers. They have a YouTube channel, which they are setting up as a partner channel on YouTube. They have invited me to join their network as a partner. We are currently in negotiations over how all of that is going to work. What I wanted to do is let you know, as loyal viewers, that this was coming, and that there's a very strong likelihood that I will be joining their partner network. So what do I get out of it, or what does CouchWarrior get out of it? Really what it does is it's going to give us a little bit broader exposure. It's going to allow me to submit videos of my choosing to their network for review and hopefully draw some new participants into our storyline here. And what they get out of it, of course, is my content will fill a hole in their current offering. They don't currently have anything of this type, and they've been reviewing my videos for a while and thought that this style of gameplay, this type of let's play, would be a great complement to the content they already have. So just wanted to let you know that's going on. One of the things that was important to me in all of this is that I didn't lose any of my creative freedom, and I will not be. I will be producing the videos just as I always have. The one exception will be that those videos that I choose to submit to their network will have an N4G TV banner at the beginning for a few seconds before I go into my own banner in my standard Erinus Arcana load screens, or intro screens, if you will. So Just wanted to let you know. I don't know exactly when that is going to be happening, but in all likelihood, to be fair to all of the new viewers who will be joining us for this storyline, I will probably be doing some kind of recap to sort of mark the beginning of these videos being posted to that network. So those folks who come to us to follow the story from that network can get a little, can get up to speed quickly with what Couch Warrior is, what this story is all about. They can understand where the older episodes are and kind of move forward from there. So just wanted to let you know, I've got so many great loyal viewers right now. Last time I checked, I think I was up to about 225 subscribers. And I appreciate every single one of you, and thought I owed it to you as loyal viewers to kind of let you know what was coming. And not all the videos I produce will go to N4G. I haven't decided exactly which ones will, but in all likelihood, this storyline at some point, probably during Chapter 4, will start being published there as well. You will continue to find all of my videos here at Couch Warrior. All of my videos will continue to be loaded here at Couch Warrior. They will just be, in addition, submitted to their network. So that was another thing that was important to me. I didn't want to be having to, you know, double my upload times and upload my videos to two channels. So, you know, that works out pretty well for me too. I don't have to change my production setup in any way. I can just upload videos like I always have, and then submit those videos to their network as well. So, all right, we are in Dragonreach. What I'm going to do is take this opportunity to enchant this mask, and I'm going to enchant it with a Fortify Archery. That will effectively make up for the archery bonuses I'm losing by taking off the bracers that we've been using previously. I was going to look and see if he had any good spell books, but nothing I really want at this point. So let's take a quick look. Here's the mask, Black Mage mask. I can add Fortify Archery to that, and I've got a Grand Soul Gem to do it. Now I should also have a potion. I think it's an Enchanter's Draught, maybe, that'll give me another 15%. So I'm probably going to slam that first, and then we'll do this enchantment. One of the things that we should probably talk about at some point in the future, and I'd love to get feedback on, is what's fair in terms of enchantments. Now that so many of us are using mods, there are literally, you know, probably 7 or 8 different things that I could enchant with a Fortify Archery. At what point does it become gratuitous? At this point, I'm kind of working under the model that I'm still going to stick with a maximum of 4 items per enchantment. So really what I'm doing here is I'm trading one enchanted item for another. I'm not adding an additional enchanted item. But I'm interested in hearing what people have to say about that, because it is possible that you could do a cowl and bracers and a mask. You could probably do a cape or a cloak, not to mention the obligatory, you know, ring and necklace. By that point, I mean, you've already reached 6 archery enchants, and I have found some sets of armor that add specific little trinkets that you can even wear that can be enchanted. So I'm interested in getting people's opinions on when does it become gratuitous or when does it break the game. My philosophy at this point is that I'm going to stick with the traditional 4 items per enchant. I may mix and match where those things are, though, and go with something non-standard if it fits me a little bit better. So in this case, I'm enchanting a mask, and I've got my cowl besides, and then I'm shedding the bracers and exchanging those for my shrouded gloves. So now I can get my backstab, and I can get the damage that I'm used to with my bow without having to constantly swap gear. What I don't want to be doing is swapping gear, because that's just not realistic. So feedback on that would be great. Well, dear viewers, we've reached the end of another episode. Thank you for taking the journey with me. And until next time, may all that you do be swift, quiet, and deadly. And to all Skyrim assassins, I salute you. Silence is our battle cry. You've been watching Arinus Arcana, a Skyrim Let's Play. If you liked this video, please rate, like, and subscribe. For more information on this and other Couch Warrior broadcasts, visit me on the web at www.couchwarrior.tv.